I think it's a great privilege for me to be here, especially when you see to chair a session where one generation younger person is speaking to take genomics technology forward. Dr. Thangaraj is a very soft-spoken, unassuming, hard-working, brilliant scientist who has made a very important footprint in the area of application of genomics technology in understanding migration of people. Dr. Thangaraj joined CCMB in, I think, in 1993, and I know him since then. And he worked with late Dr. Lalji Singh, who was the discoverer of DNA fingerprinting and who headed the CCMB director for a long time and was responsible for DNA fingerprinting to be brought into this country's legal system. As Thangaraj, I met Thangaraj during writing the document when we were writing, right, that fingerprinting law, fingerprinting process, how DNA fingerprinting can be used for paternity, for criminal, for all sorts of things. Dr. Thangaraj grew in the same group of Dr. Lalji Singh. And the first time I think we started working together is 2002, when we had Indian Genome Variation Project, where myself that time was the director of IGIB, Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology. And our idea was to map Indian genome variation to see across the population. And Dr. Thangaraj played a very important role because he had access to large number of tribal population, including Andaman, Nicobar, and other islands. That was the first comprehensive genetic landscape of people of India. It's great honor that some science done this. Actually, it is exhibited in the National Museum in the Anthropology Department of Calcutta. If you go to the National Museum, you will see the landscape of India is a, it has a panel. And that work was 100% done by all people participating from India, and Thangaraj played a very important role along with Dr. Lalji Singh. It was me and Lalji Singh who coordinated it, but Thangaraj and Dr. Mithali Mukherjee played very, very important role in building this landscape. With that foundation, subsequently, Dr. Lalji Singh and Dr. Thangaraj took forward to see how migration of people have taken place. It was very clear that out of Africa is the population that has come to India, and we have approximately four major population and one mid-mixture population. So it goes to Indo-European, Tibeto-Burman, Austroasiatic, and Dravidian population. There were discussions whether the population moved from South Indian, so out of Africa, it was very clear, somewhere between 70,000 years back, and between around 30,000 years, I think as the resources get depleted, people start moving. And those days it was land connectivity rather than. So there were very major work Thangaraj has done on the Andaman Nicobar tribal population to show how they're related to various parts. The second most important contribution came was then looking at how Southeast Asian and Asian and East Asian population migration. There were multiple hypotheses, and I'm sure he will talk about it today. And one of the interest was that we participated in a Pan-Asia project, STIPS project, including India, China, Taiwan, Japan, Korea, Singapore, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia and Philippines. And it turns out that the population actually migrated. One part of the population migrated towards the East Asia. So technically, then the color of the skin, things changed as an environmental effect. And of course, there is a reverse flow also has taken place, maybe through the Tibeto-Burman population that we have. So there were discussions about how as we connected to West Asia, as well as European population. Are there a reverse migration or not? There were discussions. And I think on this, Thangaraj and Dr. Lalji Singh played a very important role. I'm sure Thangaraj is here today. One of the major reasons is that recently he has demonstrated very interesting work, bringing in collaboration with Harvard University and others, and also one work with the Pune Institute. I forget the name of the institute.
Deakin College.
Deakin College. So it's a, I'm sure he will talk about it, right? And it's a very interesting integration of knowledge of anthropology, history, then huge use of radiophysics, radiation physics, carbon dating, and genomics, how all this can bring together to tell and remove some sort of myth that we have, especially in the samples of bones taken from upper Himalaya, and to show that many stories gets built up, but history, but actual science is not that necessarily that story, right? It says about, I'm sure you'll tell about that family was on cars, but it is not true. And so therefore it is, I think it's a very interesting example of a set of work that where India has the large resources, especially Indus Valley Civilization area. How do you use tools? These are very powerful. You know, I can tell you, I'm very proud to say 20 years back, all Indian knowledge base based on resources were all analyzed at England, weather all or laboratories. Today, India has, although we did not participate in the first round of genome sequencing, we didn't have resource, but today we have the enormous capability, as good as anybody else in the world in genomics technology, so that we can exploit our own knowledge and take it forward. Genomics has two major components. One component is to know about ourselves. It is a 3 billion nucleotide sequence encoded, encrypted, very complexly encrypted. It actually sometimes surprises us how this set of information, which is very small, 3 gigabyte is not a big thing, but how come 3 gigabyte data programs and one itself from fertilization to birth to all the way program death, that when you will die. How is it? How is it? And how does it stay on? And this is the biggest challenge. This challenge remains for the whole next 100 years, because to understand and complexity. So that tells us why we live long, why some of us don't live long, why some of us get certain disease and some of us don't. So we are moving into an era of what is called well-beingness. How do we remain healthy? Does our gene permits us to stay healthy? And what is the environment that we choose? Is it chosen by the genes that we have, or the environment and the gene interaction? So these are complex issues which are slowly getting unraveled. I'm sure Thangaraj has given in his title, Health and Disease. So therefore, he may mention something about it. But I'm sure there'll be more interesting and exciting for everybody where we came from and where we came from and how did the past civilization grew and what is the relationship to Indus Valley civilization. I'm sure how genomics can answer such questions, that remains to be answered. Dr. Bino, he has been, as I said, very humble scientist, and don't do self-publicity. So that's why I think audience could have been larger if this information would have disseminated a little more better. He has been recently conferred with J.C. Bose Fellowship. He has also been Raman Research Fellow and Fellow of the Academies of our National Academy. And I request Thangaraj, it's a great honor to sit here and chair this session. Can I go and sit there?
Please, sir.
Wish you all the best.
Thank you. So good evening, all of you. So I must thank Professor Samir Brahmachari for kindly agreeing to chair this session. In fact, he has summarized my talk. So I also thank Professor Anvita Abhi and the Director IIC for organizing my talk. And special thanks to all my friends and colleagues for coming here in this weather for listening my talk. So this is the area where we have been working for last more than 2.5 decades. Try to understand our origin. And the recent past, I tried to also connect how understanding our origin also helps in understanding our health and disease. So these are the two areas which I am going to cover in this talk. As all of you are aware that this is the way we have evolved. In fact, if you come a little closer, then we and chimpanzee or our close relative in terms of evolution have evolved from a common ancestor called hominids about 6 to 7 million years ago. So what happened during the last 6 to 7 million years? There are a lot of changes, particularly the ability to make the tools for the survival. Then the ability to walk with two legs. Then the third most important one is the increase in our brain size. If you look at in the early species, chimpanzees, the brain size was predicted as similar as chimpanzee. Then slowly increased to 35% in Australopithecus, 50% in Homo habilis, then 60% in Homo ergaster. Then just before the Homo sapiens evolved, there was a species called Neanderthals, and it was predicted the brain size was even bigger than human. But this species is no more, it's vanished. But a lot of prediction, and one of the archaeologists and anthropologist, Paul Miller from Cambridge, he wrote in one of his articles, the reason why this species vanished, he said that inherent violent behavior of modern human probably responsible for vanishing of this species. Could be true, right? And all these happened because of the genetic change. As a geneticist, I strongly feel that the genetic and evolution goes together. The best example is these three brothers who have born to a normal parents. You can see they are phenotypically similar to chimpanzee or any other non-human primates. So probably the mutation which made us as the way we look like today, and there could be one strong mutation which probably happened in this family, probably germline mutation. So that brought back to chimpanzee or non-human primate-like features. Coming to when did this modern human arose, it was well known for last several years that the modern human originated in Africa about 160 to 200,000 years back. And that was, there are several papers. Again, the very recent paper, which was published in online in October 2019, in fact the printed paper was in November last month, again confirming that human species, the modern human, originated in Africa about 200,000 years back. They particularly pointed out that that was not in East Asia, but they found it that is in South Asia based on the complete mitochondrial DNA sequencing, because the haplogroups, the primitive haplogroups, are found in these places where they have analyzed large number of bone samples. From Africa, how did they go? Why did they go? So one of the papers, in fact this papers, all the authors were not biologists. They are geologists or geophysicists. So they have drilled a lake and found out that about 135 to 75,000 years back, there was a mega drought. The water level of the lakes, particularly the lake called Malava, has gone down to 95%. Therefore, there's no water. And in search of water and food, the people have started migrating out of Africa. And moving out of Africa is well known. And how did they move out of Africa and populated all over the world? There were two strong hypotheses. So one of the hypotheses was that, including historian, linguist, geneticist, anthropologists, archaeologists, all says that the first out of Africa human might have taken the northern land route. Others didn't believe on that because the climatic condition probably not favored this. So they believed that probably the first out of Africa human must have taken the southern coastal route. And mostly these are all based on the archaeological evidence present in most of these places. The archaeological evidence present in Australia suggests that the modern human must have arrived Australian continent about 50,000 years back, China 39,000 years back, Middle East 47,000 years back, and Europe about 40,000 years back. So unfortunately, until very recently, we don't have any archaeological evidence to suggest that when the modern human must have arrived in Indian subcontinent. There are few evidence. So one of the evidence which came from a place called Jawalapuram in Andhra Pradesh, where there was an excavation, they found lot of tools which probably the modern human might have used. But there was no biological remains was found here to confirm that these are the one which was used by the modern human. Similarly, there are other places, particularly in Tamil Nadu, there are two places. One place is called Kiradi. Again, there's a lot of excavation, several stages. They found a lot of artifacts. And again, there was no biological remain of modern human, but still they are in searching for that. Another place called Adichanallur, again that's near Madurai, where it was found that this was of the period between 905 and 696 BCE. There was some bone was found, but has been kept in museum, which we are trying to explore and see. Maybe in few months or a year, we may able to say so something about peopling of that particular region. And we are fortunate to have sample from Arappa region. It's one full skeleton. We have analyzed and found that the genome doesn't have the step from Iran or Iran farmers, whereas the genome has part of the founder of the founding population of India, that is the Andamanese or ancestral South Indian. I'll come a bit late about this. And the Iranian hunter-gatherers, and was found about 300 to 400 BCE. Although it's not telling about when did the modern human arrive, because considering the fact this is recent. However, this tells about probably the agriculture must have started independently in India. It was not brought by, probably much later they must have brought, but at this point of time, 300 to 400 BCE, they have not brought the agriculture because they're all hunter-gatherers. Another study where we have looked at about 500 skeletons, particularly from Iran and Central Asia, and that tells that there was a migration of people from Central Asia to not only to India and also towards Europe. Probably they are the one who brought the Indo-European language, and that was not that old again, and this was about 1000 to 2000 BCE. Again, it's not telling about the founding population of Indian subcontinent. Although we don't have, because there are several other studies, we are part of it. There was 7,000 and 8,000 year old bone sample which was found in Europe. We strongly believe that there are three different founding population to Europe, because they are very old samples. Some migrated from Iran, which they took agriculture and so on. But we don't have that many thousand year old bone samples. However, we have collection of large number of population in India who practice the endogamy marriage practice. So we thought that exploring the genetic information from these population may help us in understanding about when did the modern human must have arrived in Indian subcontinent. So what is interesting about India or Indian population, are the populations of India are well stratified in many ways. One of the stratification is based on language. There are four major linguistic groups: Dravidians, the Tamil, Kannada, Malayalam and Telugu. The five states in southern part of India, they speak Dravidian language. Similarly, people living here speak Austroasiatic language. People live in northeast and northern part of India, they speak Tibeto-Burman, and the rest of them speak the Indo-European language. Again, under each family, there are several languages. So in addition to that, there are several other languages, isolated language, particularly like Andamanese, where Professor Anvita Abhi has done a lot of work on these languages. This other language also called Nihali, and many more small languages which are spoken by small group of people in a restricted place. Another classification is, again under each linguistic group, there are several social stratification. Like we have so-called upper caste, middle caste, lower caste, tribes, primitive tribes, and so on. So all of them put together makes India as a very complex country. In India, we have more than 4,600 anthropologically well-defined population groups, including several tribes, primitive tribes, and hunter-gatherer. Means that just they go and hunt for food. They don't do any job, including agriculture. So as I mentioned, what we are going to see in the next maybe 30-35 minutes is that how such a complex population structure evolved, who are the populations who came and settled for the first time, and what is the relationship between different population groups as one. The second one, as all of you are aware, that we practice endogamy, and we are going to see how the endogamy or marrying within the population has impact on our health and disease. Let's look at the first one. We have been working on last 2.5 decades, as I mentioned earlier, and to our surprise, we came to know the first out of Africa human is living in Indian subcontinent. They are none other than the tribal populations of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. I don't know how many of you are aware that there's a population in Indian subcontinent who are typically looks like African and live in this particular lifestyle. To give you a little more about the island, there are 572 islands. There are 6 tribal groups. 4 of them typically look like Africans, as you see in the previous picture. Jarvas, Great Andamanese, Sentinelese, and Onge. Sentinelese are the one who are still in isolation. Nobody can go near them. They will shoot with arrow. That's what happened recently, about a year back. One American tourist tried to go there, and they have killed him. And 2 of them typically look like the Southeast Asian population, like Nicobaris and Champagne. They look like people like Southeast Asian group. The number of these groups are very, very less. So one of the reasons could be the Britishers, when they wanted to construct the cellular jail to put our all freedom fighters, they have killed most of them. And again, that's interesting to see in that after killing, they took the skull and air sample of these tribal groups and kept in British Museum in Cambridge. I don't know what was the reason for them, but of course that had helped us in collecting some sample, analyzing, and compare that with the contemporary tribal groups. The Nicobaris are one which are large in number. Again, Champagne is very less. So we collected the samples from these tribal groups. This is a Onge tribe, which was collected somewhere in the mid-90s. And we used different approaches genetically. So one of the approach is looking at the mitochondrial DNA sequence. Because the mitochondria are inherited maternally, to want to trace the maternal lineage, mitochondrial marker is the best one. Again, worldwide mitochondrial DNA markers have been assigned with the different haplogroups. When we sequence the complete mitochondrial DNA, which is 16.5 kilobase or 16,500 base pairs, we would see the variation between the individual. As you see here, there are different spots. In one of the sequence of G, other one is A, or guanine and adenine. And some are highly polymorphic. We don't use those. Some are evolutionarily conserved. So we use that to make a phylogenetic tree. This is called parsimonious tree. And every line are defined with the set of mitochondrial DNA mutations. As you see here, there are certain haplogroups are restricted only in Africa. This is a L-derived haplogroup, L1, L2, and L3. And along with this mutation, there's some more mutation will put the individual into M haplogroup. As you see here, most of the Indians are with M haplogroup. So every step, there are set of mutation which defines the haplogroups. As you see here, every country or every continent are with defined haplogroups. When we sequence the Andamanese mitochondrial DNA, we thought that probably they will fall into L-derived haplogroup because they are typically look like Africans. But to our surprise, they did not fall into M haplogroup or L haplogroup because they have acquired unique set of mutation which is not found in any individual or any group in the world. These are the unique mutations, and these are the number which defines that position on the mitochondrial DNA sequence. And based on the mutation, one can assign age of the population. And with this information, we concluded some time ago that probably the Andamanese are the first modern human migrated out of Africa, taking southern coastal route and reaching Andaman and Nicobar Islands about 65,000 to 70,000 years back. And of course, the later studies shows that they have further migrated to Australia. There are group in Malaysia called Orang Asli. Some moved to Australia, Australian Aboriginals, Orang Asli, Andamanese, and some group in southern part of India, particularly Kurumba, still share some genetic affinities. Of course, those two papers were published in the same issue, so there was a write-up by Peter Foster, so suggesting that this is the route, mentioning both the papers. So this is the first evidence suggesting that the Andamanese are the first modern human migrated out of Africa. So we have the first modern human who migrated out of Africa in Indian subcontinent. Then the technology changed, human genome was sequenced, and the difference between ethnic groups have been identified. And there was an array has been made with nuclear genes. Now 1 million variations one can look at in a one given experiment. So that we have used from nuclear genes which are contributed by both the parents. We also used the Y chromosome markers, which I'm not saying here, as the mitochondrial DNA inherited or inherits maternally. The Y chromosome inherits paternally. So all the males will have the similar Y chromosome in a family or in a ethnic group. Whereas the autosomal markers are inherited from both the parents, father and mother. So based on our knowledge using both Y chromosome and mitochondrial DNA markers, now we selected carefully that we don't want to do any repeated analysis. So we selected 132 individuals from 25 populations covering 15 states representing all the linguistic groups, Dravidian, Indo-European, Austroasiatic, Tibeto-Burman, and Great Andamanese. Then we also used data from Human Genome Diversity Panel and HapMap dataset. And we used several statistical methods. And I'll give you just one example with one method called PCA, this is a principal component analysis, where we have large number of Indian groups which we analyzed. And these are the HapMap data set, Europeans, Africans, and Chinese HapMap data. So this alone tells us the complexity of Indian populations. while Europeans, Africans and Chinese hapmap samples are in a very tight clusters. There are large number of samples suggesting that genetically they are more homogeneous, therefore they are in one single cluster. Whereas look at Indians, so each Indian population is unique because of our endogamy marriage system, marrying within the group. So every population acquired unique set of mutation, that's what makes every population as unique. So what we can say here is that India is not inhabited by a single large population as we see here in these three hapmap sample. Rather, we can say that India is inhabited by large number of small populations. So what was the conclusion at the time? Was the Andamanese and the Africans are deep-rooted divergence, while Andamanese were migrating to Andaman. Some groups stayed back in southern part of India, whom we call as ancestral South Indian, who probably colonized India for the very first time. Then the second wave of migration, which took place, and one group has gone to Europe, some group has come to northern part of India, whom we call as ancestral North India. So these are the two founding group of Indian subcontinent. And these two groups have admixed and gave rise to many populations. And what we concluded was, at the time, all Indians are admixed, otherwise we would not have seen the close affinities between the groups. And we also predicted that there could be high frequency of recessive disease in India. And coming to this admixture, when this admixture would have taken place, ANI and ASI, or ancestral North Indian and ancestral South Indian. To address that, we made another study taking large number of sample from South and large number of sample from the North. And based on the recombinations, because every generation there will be a recombination between the homologous chromosomes, and based on that information, what we predicted was this: these two founding groups, ancestral South Indian and ancestral North Indians, have initially gave rise to many populations independently. Then they have admixed during the last 2,000 to 4,000 years, as it indicated here. After admixing, every single population started maintaining the endogamy, means marrying within the group. Because of that, now every population is unique, because during last 2,000 years, each population must have acquired unique set of mutation. If you analyze that, that makes every population as unique population. Probably the caste system which arose during 1,000-1,500 years must have put more pressure on that to make it even more stringent. So initially the two founding populations, they have admixed during last 2,000 to 4,000 years. Then every population started maintaining the endogamy. So that's the reason in the PCA, we see there is a uniqueness, but still there is a close connection. Now let us look at what is the impact of this endogamy marriage practice. So now to look for that information, we not only restricted to India, we also took samples from other South Asian countries, because genetically India is mother for the most of the South Asian countries, South Asian countries, because 50% of the genome of South Asian countries have gone from India. The second aspect is some of the disease, or some of the disease-causing mutation which we found in India is also found in South Asian countries, but not in other countries. So one of the example, there are several such mutation. One of the mutation is in a gene called myosin binding protein C3. This is one of the important gene essential for cardiac muscle contraction. because it connects both thick and thin filament. If there is a mutation in this particular gene, it ultimately leads to cardiomyopathy. Cardiomyopathy is a heart muscle disease and leads to sudden cardiac death. When we found this mutation, there's a 25 base pair deletion in the intron, which skips away one of the wild type exon. Therefore, there's a truncation of the protein. Hence, it leads to the disease. When the mutation is in both the copy of the chromosome, this mutation is on chromosome 11. We have 46 chromosomes, 23 pairs. So one of the pair we receive from father, one from the mother. If both of them contribute to the mutation and they become homozygous, both the copies carrying the mutation, then the individual die at very, very early age. That we confound by looking at the postmortem tissue of the young children who died due to cardiac disease. But if it is the heterozygous condition, they will be absolutely fine until the age of 40 or 45. But suddenly, when they are athlete particularly, or they are very active running or cycling, then they collapse, and only then it leads to the sudden cardiac death. When we tried to look for this mutation within India, we found 4% of the Indians carrying this mutation in the heterozygous condition. Then we tried to look for that worldwide, and to our surprise, we see that mutation, the yellow ones, which is present only in South Asian country, but not in other country. So we thought that let's take other South Asian country people to look for the impact of endogamy, because other South Asian country also follows the endogamy marriage. So here we took 2,800 samples from 275 endogamous group, and the color indicates the Dravidian, Austroasiatic, Tibeto-Burman, and Indo-Europeans, and also Andamanese, Nepalis, and few more isolated groups. When we started analyzing, to our surprise, we found that most of the Indian populations, at least one third of the Indian populations, are having high IBD score, that identity by descent. Means, in simple term, that if you take two unrelated individuals in a population and compare the large stretch of DNA sequence, if they are really unrelated, then there should be lot more variation between these two sequences. But what we have seen is at least one third of the population which we analyzed are showing the high frequency of the similar sequence, suggesting that at least in one third of the Indian populations, we expect there could be a population-specific recessive disease. If it's a dominant disease, one of the chromosome has a mutation, then it expresses. In the recessive disease, if one chromosome carries the mutation, one is normal, called as heterozygous, then you don't see the disease. But imagine there's a population which is founded by one family, one parents, for example. In a village setup, you may see there are 50 families or 100 families. All must have come from a single parent. If the founder carries a mutation, then the mutation is distributed or circulated and amplified in the population. Then there's a chance that two individuals who probably unrelated today, but they maybe might have been come from the same common ancestor, carrying the mutation in heterozygous condition, they're absolutely fine. When they marry, there's a 25% of chance that they are going to contribute, both of them contributing the mutant chromosome, therefore there's a disease. So that is very, very high among Indian population. As you see, every line is one population. And there are two red color lines, as is shown here, one is Ashkenazi Jewish and other one is Finnish population, and consider the IBD score of these two population, which are very well studied, a large number of disease has been identified, large number of mutation responsible for the disease has been identified, which I will tell you later. But with tiny IBD, they have huge number of disease, and think what would be the consequences of large number of Indian population who have several fold higher IBD compared to these two populations. How it can be simplified? This is a pedigree, or you can call as family tree. The circle is female, square is male. If you put line, this is a marriage line you can consider. And these two are their daughter, right? And consider this is the chromosome segment which carries the mutation in a heterozygous condition. There's no problem with this lady. And she is passing on to both her daughters. Again, it is in the heterozygous condition, no problem. Both of them married somebody from outside. Again, is going in heterozygous condition, no problem until here. But imagine, so if it goes for next few more generation, now these two individuals have lost their relationship, and now they are from the same community or caste, but unrelated, carrying the mutation in heterozygous condition. But if they marry, that's a chance of 25% of the children will carry the mutation in homozygous condition, therefore there's a disease. So that condition is very, very high among Indians. And compared, we compared Ashkenazi Jewish and Finnish population. And we see that there are a large number of diseases has been mapped in Ashkenazi Jewish. Most of them are autosomal recessive, except few autosomal dominant disease. With the very tiny IBD, they have such issue, same way in Finnish population. But imagine with very high IBD, high IBD score, what would be the consequences of health issues among most of the Indian populations? I'll give you a couple of examples. So one of the population which follow very high endogamy practice is Vaishya. They are mostly in Andhra Pradesh, particularly in Hyderabad. So they have a pseudocolon esterase deficiency. So because of that, if they are given the common anesthesia, so they remain in anesthetic effect for a very long time. And most often it leads to paralysis. Because we have gene for every function. And if you take the pharmacologically important gene, so every drug which we consume, there's a gene which metabolize. If there's a mutation in that particular gene, then rather than giving therapeutic effect, it may give us the adverse effect. Same way in this case, there's a mutation which leads to such a problem. But in terms of the population history, what we found for the last 108 generation, this population is maintaining the endogamy. Therefore, there's a founding mutation which is circulating within the population. For the last 108 generation, there's no gene flow on both the sides. They are not going out and marrying somebody, or they're not marrying somebody from outside. Another example is to confirm our hypothesis that due to endogamy, there's a lot of issues, particularly recessive disease. We took one well-known disease called progressive pseudorhomatoid dysplasia. This is caused by autosomal recessive mutation in WISP3 gene. And this is the phenotypic impact of the disease. And this childhood disease where you see the swelling of all the joints and bone abnormalities. And these children are born to a normal parent. Both father and mother are absolutely fine because this mutation is recessive. So to understand this, whether these mutations have some kind of founder effect, we sequence the gene of 32 patients, and we found 6 patients are with the mutation, it's the same mutation, and try to understand whether all the 6 have come from a common founder. We sequence the flanking region of the mutation and found 5 out of 6 are with the same haplotype, no difference between the sequence of the 5 individuals, suggesting that all the 5, although today they are unrelated, they must have come from a common founder. That's the reason they have such issue. So this is just to show that this is a region where there's a mutation in that particular population, whereas that's not the case in other population. Having this information, we also look at different diseases. So one other disease which we work on is mitochondrial disease. These are very diverse phenotype, both in mutation as well as the disease phenotype, which is caused by both mitochondrial DNA as well as the nuclear genes which controls the mitochondria, particularly the gene called polymerase gamma 1, which scores for polymerase, which is essential for mitochondrial DNA replications. If there is a mutation in a heterozygous condition, as you see here, there are 2 peaks. One is blue and red. This is a wild type and this is a complete mutant. This is a heterozygous, one chromosome carrying wild type, one chromosome with mutant. And this is a consanguineous family where you see that both the parents have come from the same family background, and they are 45 years and 38 years, absolutely fine, no problem at all, but they are carrying mutation heterozygous condition, CNT, as you see here. So unfortunately, the 2 children in this family, they have acquired one mutant chromosome from father, one from the mother, therefore homozygous, and this child was normal when we started the analysis and died by the time we complete the analysis. This has a very severe phenotype and premature death. This is one example where we see the heterozygous are fine, but the homozygous are with very severe phenotype. We don't know how many populations are with this kind of mutation, and most often these are not reported to medical community because in the rural setup, there's a death in the family, 1 or 2 family, but they're not going to report to the medical community. So that's how we don't see most of this information in any form of record. This is a consanguineous family. Again, you can see that non-consanguineous family, the issue is the same. And this is very unfortunate that both the children have died. So this information we put together to make the scientific community aware that in India or South Asia, there's a huge promise for mapping a population-specific disease-causing genes. So with this information, what is essential is something like what the Ashkenazi Jewish do. They have an organization called Dor Eshem, where this organization goes to school, collect the sample from the school children, sequence and put them into the database. When they grow and come to the stage where they are ready to get married, boy identify the girl or girl identify the boy, then they take out the sequence, compare and see whether both of them carrying the same mutation which causes the disease in homozygous condition. If that is the case, they advise either not to marry, or even they marry, they have to keep watching that particular mutation and decide at the time of pregnancy. So this is kind of the clue. On this basis, we also developed recently to take the ideal is that take all the population which shows very high IBD score and do the exome sequencing, identify the mutation, screen them in the population, then give counseling to the families. With that, we just initiated as a small genome, there's a 1,000 genome project which recently has been announced by the minister, where IGAB and the CCMB was part of it, and we selected three population, one of the population called Handikudu. As you see here, again, this is restricted. Only this population has the features like very short stature and there's a bone abnormality. Large number of individuals. And the area is called Andikudu. The name is name of the disease is named after that, Andikudu disease. Another one is Udanam nephropathy. A place in Andhra Pradesh, in the coastal area, there's a large number of people, not only the old, even the middle age or young people are with nephropathy. It's a very unknown nephropathy. There are a lot more work was done to look at whether there is a problem with water or problem with the environment. They could not find anything. So we wanted to see how this is going to happen. Similarly, there are a large number of diseases which have been reported by the doctors. They see that in a selected place, there's a predominant disease. For example, there's a community called Raju in Andhra Pradesh. In a one particular place, they have high prevalence of cardiomyopathy. Similarly, the Reddy population in one particular pocket of Andhra Pradesh, they have particular arthritis. So this tells that there is certainly a founding mutation in large number of population groups due to the endogamy, which needs to be analyzed and take it to the population, counseling, both prenatal and premarital, so that the population gets benefited. And in fact, the Ashkenazi Jewish, they are practicing this way, and in fact, they eliminated a couple of disease from their population itself. So that's how one has to carry out, and this is our just beginning. I hope that we do a little more and try to help the community. So with that, I'd like to thank all those who have contributed to this. Dr. Lalji Singh, my mentor, as Professor Brahmachari mentioned right from the beginning, I've been working with him, and unfortunately we lost him recently. Large number of my students, and I have very strong collaborations with within India and outside India, and again with the medical community. And the funding has come from CSIR, UK, that's a UK India Education Research Initiative, DBT, DST, and Medical Research Council, UK. Thank you very much. Yes.
It was so nice to listen to Thangaraj. I haven't listened to recently. I listened to you in the Indian Genetics Congress. So simplified way he has explained the process. So any question, please?
Yes.
Will you introduce yourself and ask the question so that, is there a mic around?
Sir. Thank you, sir.
Please introduce yourself and then ask the question.
Yeah, I'm Shiko from Northeast, Naga tribe. So it is a very interesting and very complicated for me. Now coming, the basic question is, do you agree or disagree the narratives of the Holy Bible, which says, in the beginning God created human beings, earth and heavens, and your presentation in Africa. And if the first human being is from Africa, why the colors are different and languages are different? Should it be a continuation of the language, etc., etc.? And then how many have you ever contacted with a Chinese group of people who are interested in this group? Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yeah, so initially there were multi-regional hypotheses, but they're all been unproved. And the African origin has very strong evidence in many ways, including genetics. And to our question that when everybody originated from Africa with a dark skin color, why we have different colors? So that's because of there are a lot more changes happen because of the selection pressure. Okay. So when people started migrating out of Africa towards Europe, for example. So we need sunlight for vitamin D synthesis. With very high melanin content, with the low sunlight, even today most often the European countries are without proper sun, right? So because of evolutionary pressure, there's a mutation in SLC24A gene, which turn our skin color into lighter skin color. Okay, so that helped us in proper vitamin D synthesis. So you can actually see that correlate with all the admixtures what we have seen. In India, unlike any other countries, we have range of colors. We can have very light skin color to very dark skin color. That's again happened because of the admixture. So not only this case about skin color and many other things, including the lactate persistence. And if you take disease, we have sickle cell mutation because of the malaria prevalence. There's a mutation introduced in the gene, and the red blood cell becomes sickles, therefore the malarial parasite could not enter. So the most of the changes what we see here because of the necessary for the human being. I don't know what else you have asked.
Yeah, coming back to the first question about Bible, I think I will take that question and say Darwinian evolution has clearly demonstrated how actually human can be evolved all the way. I still don't know, you know, all our religious or spiritual skips will have certain purpose, but I think as a scientist, Darwinian evolution is the fundamental principle and basis on which modern human has arrived all the way. So how did from a bacteria to multicellular organism to small organism to mammalian to all the way has come, I think you have got some answer from his talk. But the most fundamental difference is the fourth layer of the brain that got developed from chimpanzee to human. You know, what all animal kingdom cannot do, we can do. And that's because of the fourth layer of the brain development. We still don't understand because the brain mapping project has started only 2013. Maybe another decade, we'll understand how all brain development of the fourth layer has actually made what human, modern human is. So therefore, I think that's the right way to go. Is that? Yes. Give him the mic. Yeah. You have a question? Okay, we'll take the...
Dr. Thangaraj, I'm K.N. Srivastava, Director of IIC. I've got two short questions to ask. One is about this RNA invasion theory. I would like to, you know, hear something from you because, you know, that has got a lot of civilizational issues vis-a-vis the Indus Valley civilization, the continuum of Indian, you know, civilization, and all kinds of things go on. Have you studied, you know, that aspect from genomics point of view? The second question I would like to ask, the second not question, actually observation. You know, I hail from Karnataka state cadre. Mm-hmm. There are two communities in Karnataka. They're very small in number. One is Kannada is speaking Reddis. Mm-hmm. You talked of Reddis, but they're all Telugu speaking.
Yeah.
You've got a very small population of Kannada speaking Reddis. Since endogamy has been common everywhere, so you find that a lot of, you know, I mean, children are born with all kinds of, biological problems and disorders. And the same thing is noticed in another Muslim community called Nawayats. They are in Bhatkal Taluka, on the coast of Karwa district. So those Muslims, they don't marry with other Muslims. And because of that, the small group, they also suffer the similar kind of a thing. My recommendation will be that since we have studied all these communities quite intensively in Andhra Pradesh, it is worthwhile to have a look at these two communities also.
Sure, sure.
Because a lot of information will come once you study them.
Sure. I will take the detail of this population.
Nawayats, Muslim community. Where is exactly in Karnataka?
Bhatkal, Bhatkal.
Bhatkal.
Bhatkal, Bhatkal.
Bhatkal, Bhatkal.
Actually, it is believed that the Muslim traders, Arab traders, they had come and settled there, they married locals, and that how the community developed.
Karnataka structure is little different than Andhra structure. The reason is simple. You will see that a lot of Khanuj Brahmins all the way from Kashmir moved to Karnataka. So when you come to Karnataka, there are population structure of Karnataka has a little unusual. That's why you see so many fair people in Karnataka. And so therefore, this is a little more complex Karnataka structure than... So one can trace back and check.
Yeah, so there, rightly said, because the Kurk and many more populations have the European related ancestries. And also population Goa and some towards Karnataka called Catholic Brahmins.
Yeah.
So they also have a lot of European ancestries.
One of the reasons historically people say that the temples were built and we needed very scholarly pandits. So Kashmiri pandits were brought to manage those temples. And that's how historically admixture has taken place in the population. So there are, so Karnataka is a little more complex calculation. Second reason is Karnataka, one more complex comes because of the Tipu Sultan fought British soldiers. And Devonshire soldiers were actually positioned. So Tipu Sultan won three times, we published in Lancet long back, that three times defeated those soldiers and he captured them. And he wanted to make sure that he has a better breed of extraordinary good soldiers. So they got married locally. And then finally, fourth time he lost. And then 25,000 Devonshire soldiers, because it came out because the Huntington disease in Devonshire is the highest incident. And Karnataka, Nimhans, got the data that they have a very high Huntington disease association, and then it had two different haplotypes. So Indian origin, what he says, founder effect and the Huntington disease. So that clearly showed that as the colony grew, these diseases taking place. So one can go back and show that they had sexually transmitted, 25% of the soldiers had sexually transmitted disease. Dr. Sanjeev Jain and our group, we did it. So there are, Karnataka is a little more complex than, as you said, than Andhra Pradesh.
Even there's one more population called Siddhis.
Siddhis.
They're also in Karnataka.
Yeah. Yeah, I think they have come to few hundred years back from Africa. Am I right?
Pardon?
Those population. This question here, there's a question there, huh?
Yeah, so there's one more question about Aryan. That's a very, very complex story. I think Tony is there. He's a very strong supporter of that. But still, it's very complex. As for some markers we look at, then we say that, okay, so there's a migration. Even the paper, the science paper which you mentioned, there was a migration, but that doesn't have a very strong influence on our population. So, but it's a very recent migration.
Can we take the question there?
Rakhigiri, I presented Rakhigiri sample. There's only one sample. Yeah. So that has ancestry from ancient Andamanese and ancestry from Iranian hunter-gatherers.
Correct. Yes.
My name is Deepak Datlani. You mentioned in your presentation that the Andamans and Nicobar Islands were populated around 40,000 years back.
60,000.
60,000. Okay. And it is believed, I think Tony Joseph in his books mentioned that Australia was populated around 25,000 years back. Now,
Tony is sitting there.
He'll say 50.
Probably not 25, 50.
Okay.
Around 50.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, my question is, which I think he's also mentioned in his book, at that time there were no sailing skills. So, how did 50,000 years back people reach Andaman Nicobar Islands or Australia without the ability to cross oceans? You know, because all the migration was by land, you know.
Yeah, don't go back to say that there was a Ram Setu and all, we'll get into trouble, okay? If you look at the map,
they were
connected. There was some connection. There's this migration has taken place. So you can see, if you actually do a jigsaw puzzle of Africa and this part of Asia, almost looks like that there was a certain amount of connectivity. I don't know how, but that's the main belief.
But still, they have a good ability to, I have seen when I collected the sample from Onge, they have ability, they cut the tree,
small
and dig
boat.
Out the middle portion and leave the rest, no, and use as the boat to travel. And they also ability
all along the coast.
60,000 years back.
Yeah. No. Probably they must have developed during this process, but we don't know when they have developed, but they have ability. It's not the recent one, the ancient kind of
ability. But land connectivity, if I correct geologist, anybody here, there were certain land connectivity between Africa and this part of Asia. I think I don't remember the exact reference,
but
there was a certain, which has continental drift has taken place. So therefore, it's possible.
It would have happened much before the migration, because this is very recent.
This is true.
The continental drift was much, much earlier.
Also, there's an ice age.
So they might have used both land,
frozen,
and coast.
Correct.
Yeah. Mike.
Yes.
This is Joya Roy. I'm completely innocent of any knowledge on genetics, but I'm always wondering about certain things. One is the Mundas. Mundas, Kharia, and others in Jharkhand, the tribes, they have creation myths of how they came from somewhere else, but they couldn't go back because the seas divided them. So they may have come over glacial ice masses. And the other thing is the Australian tourism brochures or the government brochures talk about their tribes as having, the aboriginals having come about from 70 to 140,000 years ago. So that is much earlier than you're talking of the coming via the Asian subcontinent and then going across to Andaman Islands and then going to...
But I don't know. That was not actually been scientifically proven. I don't know where from this you got that.
50 is the oldest.
From the government brochures, 50 is the oldest. And there are many studies which support around 50,000 years. That's the maximum time period.
And may I ask one more question?
Yeah,
in
please.
David Reich's, I was listening to him on YouTube. And first of all, I couldn't understand why they focus on this Yamuna population in this one place and not a sort of much wider group into the Urals and the Russian and other areas. And secondly, when he talks about the South Indian subcontinent, he really has only two samples. One is from Swat. Both are in Pakistan. Was he not permitted to take samples in India? Say from Kashmir or Himachal or anywhere else?
No, these are the bone samples, because most of this samples, about 500 plus samples.
Indus Valley.
From
Pakistan area. Sindh area. Am I right?
Right. Yeah.
Swat.
So these samples are the bone sample which you could get easily with the collaboration. So some of the samples are not that easy to collect.
But the Indus Valley, those are Kankhal that we see, you know.
So
even in the museum here, is it possible to extract ancient DNA from
Yes, it's possible, depending upon the condition in which the samples are. Some are, if fossilized, so difficult to extract DNA.
So has it been done?
In fossilized, it has not been done. In fossilized sample, you could not do. But some of the sample which now in association with Archaeological Survey of India, we are trying to get some sample. Probably after a couple of years, we may have much better information about most of the population.
Oh.
That's
I'm Anvita Abbi and I'm a linguist. So my question, of course, would be based on our research on the languages of the Andamans. I'm presently working on Nicobaris, but we don't have enough evidences to either refute or confirm your findings. As far as the Andaman is concerned, the migration, as one gentleman was a little concerned, and Peggy Mohan was right in saying that, yes, the sea level was very, very low at the time of 70,000 years ago when they migrated. And if you look at the topography, the Arakan range of Burma is a continuation of the tip of the Andaman Islands, which, as you know, are as big, were as big mountains as perhaps Himalaya, but now they are submerged in the sea. So Andaman is definitely must have walked from Burma to, you know, the Andaman Islands. So it was a walking trip and not the by the sea boat trip. The what you are talking about, the Onges boats, I have lived with the Onges in Little Andaman and have seen the how they make it hollow. But I don't think at that time, 70,000 years ago, they had tools to make them. So the I think the walking theory is much better explained. And if you look at the topography of the world, 70,000 years ago was not the same as what it is today. So considering the linguistic research, I have written about it, and perhaps you've read it, that our linguistic research shows that the Jarvas and Onges seem to be a later migrants than the Andamanis. Mm-hmm. And I remember talking about this to Lalji Singh when he was alive, and he said, well, we don't have proofs. Well, the linguists don't have as robust proofs as you have, like DNA sample and chromosome. But the old languages, which are not contaminated by outside contact, some leave some archaic structures through which we can do reconstruct. And it appears that Great Andamanese is perhaps the oldest language of this world, maybe one of the oldest, you know, unless somebody proves me wrong. But Jarwa and Onge seem to be much later. So do you think there was a second migration in Andaman?
I don't think so, because they're all, if you look at the Y chromosome, except Great Andamanese Y chromosome, all modern. Jarwa, Onge are sharing the same Y chromosome haplogroup, confirming that they're all from the same
part of
migrant and parental lineage. Whereas looking at the mitochondria, again, all are M31 and M32. Again, suggesting that maternally they're all related, only there are some sub haplogroup. Otherwise, they are from the same probably migration.
Oh, more questions. Just take this and then.
No, so if you funnel it back to the original source from where the populations migrated maybe 70 or 50,000 years ago, does that concentrate into small regions in Africa and whatever the remnant populations there, however small the section is, are these original gene types still found in them, and are they across? Because I read that there was it all started from some particular patches of this thing. So what is the status there?
Yeah, unfortunately, we could not connect because the isolation was 65,000 to 70,000 years. So independently, there's a huge amount of mutation acquired by both Andamanese as well as the Africans. So we cannot actually connect them now. Whereas the recent migrants, for example, the Siddhis whom we are talking, that was 400 years back, and we could trace them to Bantu-speaking African. Because its isolation was so long, we could not be able to connect.
Yeah, environmental impact on mutation selection becomes very large, and then it's very difficult to. taking it back, because you're trying to create a history based on present. So that's like catching the shadow. You have the shadow.
If we have the ancient DNA, then you can able to connect.
Question.
Because it's in the same time period.
Please ask.
Dr. Thangarajan, the way you have studied geographically and genetically, can we relate it that some diseases are genetically more concentrated in some areas that can be handled very easily?
That is what I predicted.
So which diseases are most prominent, which area, and which disease can be controlled genetically?
In a broader area, there's no such issues, only the limited area.
But I can
area.
Tell you, from the genetic profile map, risk, you know, if you take the middle part of India, Gujarat, Maharashtra, you cannot see a person. The high risk for blood pressure, blood sugar is, you know, like that you can do the each gene risk profile of the country. And that was the Indian Genome Variations high risk to show that. Fortunately, we are not protected from HIV. We don't have a Delta 32 deletion except a small part of India. So therefore, we are risk at HIV. So, but there are regions where malaria is allele is fixed, so you're okay. And there are regions where because of malaria, thalassemia or sickle cell anemia, heterozygosity is prevalent. So you have to be very careful when you handle, if I start worrying about sickle cell anemia screening, I first take care, should be able to take care of the malaria free that area. Otherwise, I will actually kill people faster than I was trying to save them. So there are lots of complexity, and this is why it's very difficult to say. But today we know, you know, I can tell you there is a founder chromosome of SCA12, which we have seen now the large number of Agarwal community has that mutation. So therefore, they run a risk of that ataxia disease.
Same thing I'm talking about neuromuscular disorder, muscle disease in Agarwal community and communities.
Yeah.
Because they don't take protein,
animal
protein.
This is a paper I wrote long back, but you know, I'm afraid to say, because you should not start thinking every Agarwal has a problem.
No.
So that's why this is where our risk we run.
Because food habits are also different. Vegetarian, non-vegetarian makes a difference.
I don't know. We still don't know complexity, as I said. To as a scientist to tell something, it has to be evidence-based. As of now, our evidence says, yes, if you have that haplotype, then you run a risk of the disease. But doesn't mean that everyone has that haplotype. Possibility is there.
High risk.
Yes.
Asha, two quick points. One, I'm very glad someone brought up Africa, because let's not get away with the idea that only the migrants out of Africa were the earliest humans and the earliest languages, because we do know that languages in the south of Africa around the area where perhaps humanity first came into existence, the Click languages, they are there and they are extremely old too. And the Clicks have survived many migrations into that area. Second tiny point, since we keep talking about mitochondria, you've been obviously as a geneticist reading about horizontal gene transfer, and that it comes, that there is a strong suspicion that mitochondria came from a bacterial infection into the cells.
In so fact, that happened millions of years back.
Yes.
Bacterial.
not in this time scale.
In the bacterial.
Initially, the anaerobic bacteria has become the mitochondria millions of years back.
Floating around the nucleus, but not in yet.
Correct.
So it was interesting that there was a time when mutations may have come and perhaps still do come by infections like viruses which can permeate the cells.
You can see there are a lot of viral genome into the human genome. And
modern human has a lot of viral integrated.
Yes.
So
since you mentioned
retrovirus,
it.
We cannot do anything.
Yeah. Because of the environment conditions and industrialization, many more things, because that's one of the hypotheses where the evolution of modern human is much faster. Much faster in the last 10,000 years compared to earlier.
Can we get any more? Yes.
No, I just wanted to go back to the first question of if the humanoid or the human beings actually started in Africa, then you have to actually work out what happened with all these populations which spread all over the world. So clearly the one thing seems to suggest is that there were environmental factors, climatological factors, all kinds of other factors which actually influence these mm-hmm. things.
Yeah.
The other part of it is mutation. Now once you go to another place, then you can also have mutations, right? Some disease that didn't even exist can be created. So what do you think about these two things? To go back to your talk, I'm not really interested in Aryan and Dravidian right now. But just to go back to your talk. So, right. I mean, if you were linear about your thinking, then of course you'd say that there should be the same disease, that muscular disease you're talking about, should be prevalent in many, many places. Mm-hmm. But it seems not, right? So maybe it comes out of a mutation which happened only locally.
Yeah. So
just shed some light on
that. Yeah, sure. So the mutation which are due to some founding mutations are going to be restricted only in that region or in the community. But the mutation which are associated with environment are going to be in that region. For example, those who are living in Himalaya. Okay, so they have specific mutation so that the RBC carry more oxygen. Right? So it is selected there. If they come here, no problem. But if we go there without that mutation, we may face a problem. Similarly, the skin color mutation, lactate persistent gene, because there's enzyme which metabolize the milk sugar when we were young, at the time during the weaning period. But the efficiency of that will go down as we grow older. Right? When people started domesticating animals, started drinking animal milk, would have faced that problem. But now we all acquired certain mutation to tolerate that. So that mutation is common mostly in Middle East, where this agriculture and animal domestication has happened, and the northeast, northwest part of India, Europe, and so on. So other part, that mutation not there, but some other mutation exists. So in that question has two components. One is population specific, other one is environmental influence.
I think she hasn't asked a question, so she gets a chance.
So considering the genetic and cultural diversity and distinct identity in India, now coming on to the policy makers, can we really generalize this? Because I'm an anthropologist by training, now I work at ICMR. So now I'm on the other side of the bench. So it's really difficult to convince people that we are really, genetically distinct, culturally distinct. So one umbrella policy cannot really work on all of us. So from, we have been listening to the anthropological survey of India ka story, wherein the government dropped in milk packets in Andaman and they just asked people to consume it just to reduce malnutrition. So they just stacked them and build walls out of it.
Mm.
So how are we going to stress upon the personalized medicine, or how are we going to do this?
Yeah, so in this aspect, actually ICMR should play a major role because many reasons. One is right now you don't have any epidemiological data for any disease or any aspect of for human population history and so on. So you have to develop evidence-based data.
Correct.
To overcome many issues, that would take long time. So something has to be with the evidence.
Yeah, I just to tell you, 20 years back, on the request of Dr. Bhargava, a committee was made, where myself, Lalji Singh, we were all members. We wanted to create this epidemiological data in ICMR that collect actual, what is our rural, some community, average hemoglobin level, to what is the blood sugar level. Is triglyceride level in Kerala people is high, but still are they more prone? Are we using Indian standard? We have no Indian standard. when people say 118 blood sugar, it's European standard, Western standard. West decides. So therefore, this was ICMR. I didn't remember 20 years back, this committee I worked, and then fund did not come and didn't happen actually. But that was, of course, the idea one when we knew genome will be done, things will happen, so these data will be important. So yes, it's a very difficult situation today. But I can tell you, if somebody sits down and analyzes extensive genetic data that these people are already, you know, next generation is generating, especially 1,000 genome will go to 10,000 genome. And both at CCMB and IGIB, Dr. Vinod Skaria and Sridhar, I think we should be able to create a risk population basis polymorphism data. It is actually possible. And then we can take a decision that we don't need malarial vaccination in all over India. We can restrict to 100 million people. They are high risk. Similarly, we can look at cardiovascular risk in some population. We can say the diabetes eradication focus should be in this population. It's absolutely possible. If I was 20 years younger, I would have done that work.
Culture.
No, no, you don't control. You can't control anybody, okay? You can only tell that this is, you know, if I had a marker to tell that 70 million diabetic patient who will have peripheral neuropathy or nephropathy or retinopathy, it would have been fantastic because 15% people only get all this disease. 85% die in fear. They can't eat rasgulla. You know, I have 20 years diabetes. I have always the dori. So therefore, that genetic marker still awaited, right? Yeah. This was our dream that we will get that genetic. The moment you make, then 85% people are happy. I can have diabetes, but I'm not going to have any complication. And we know that. Whereas some small 5 to 3% population will get into diabetic coma. We still don't know what the genetic marker for that. So these are the challenges which next generation will take forward.
Maybe even for genetic, for diabetes, if this is happening for next several generations, probably we acquire mutation to
take care of
this.
It. Yeah. You know, there are so hypotheses which says diabetes is actually protecting your brain. Because if your blood sugar level is pumped into high, because brain uses 75% of the ATP, so to keep a sufficient blood sugar level in the brain, actually the mutation has accumulated by which you can, your average blood sugar level is high. We still don't know. You know, we are dictated by pharmaceutical companies, right? We still don't understand relationship between all this. You know, I do experiment. I measure my blood sugar every day. I note down what food I eat. So I control my blood sugar completely by food and exercise, absolutely, with medicine. But you know this is happening, and this is fine for you. You know, yesterday only I told to the AIMS doctor that 130 blood sugar is very comfortable for me. 110 is very discomfortable. He was shocked. He said, did you measure? I said, yes, I've been measuring every day. So this becomes a genomic scientist. You can do this, you know, you can play around. I know all my mutations. Fortunately, my genome is sequenced, so... Yes. Last question, I think we'll take, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, one more you have. Not bad, huh? We have a small group, but interested group, so you should be very happy.
Right. I was wondering among those 36 hunter-gatherer groups that you had sampled, whether you had also the Birhor of Chotanagpur Plateau, and whether you found anything significant about the antiquity, because they also seem to have a click language. Like the sun. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure because I'm not a linguist.
So
maybe Dr. Anvita's students have.
We don't have a sample of all the hunter-gatherers.
No, but the Birhor. They're very ancient. They refuse to touch a plow.
Can I have the last question from Northeast?
No, sir. As you mentioned earlier, you'll take the part of the Bible. I want this clarification because I do believe that human beings, according to the Holy Bible, created by God. It is my belief.
Yeah, belief is defined.
Then his presentation from Africa. That guy is the Adam what was his name, the first African?
Yeah, yeah. It could be as you are absolutely right. It could be same Adam and Eve of Africa. You can take it that way. Because must remember, the Bible was written only a few thousand years back. Right? Whatever it is. So all religions are only maximum, I think, Jewish, 5,000 years old.
Very recent, yeah.
Any religion of this world. You know, we talk so much of religion, especially now in the whole country we're talking about. They are all 500 years, 2,000 years, 2,500, 5,000 years old. So when we are talking about context of evolution and human, it's a one scale above, right? Am I right? So it is not, we are not talking. We are talking about 60, 70,000 years. There was no religion that time. Anyway, religion was only surviving.
Thank you, sir, but I don't believe. Thank you.
Okay, good. Arish.
I think we have to close or we take
the last question. Arish wanted.
I think you know him, right?
Sir, excellent presentation and work for last 20 plus years. I just want to, I don't want to ask you all those which you have already explained to the audience. I just want to ask you last slide question that is related to kidney issue, that is udon thing.
Udon, yeah.
I do, means I do have some kind of idea about what is going on there. As you know, it came in the paper and ICMR had a committee to look out those things and okay. I have a local interactions and some of the people came to University of Hyderabad and had a discussion.
Okay.
I don't know what is the reason for selecting particularly that area. Is there any specific?
We are concentrating on regional specific or population specific diseases. So this seems to be totally different compared to other kidney diseases. So udanam kidney is of unknown origin, right? So we wanted to find out what is the cause, because we also found there are many individuals in the same family affected, suggesting that there's a strong genetic basis.
Yeah, I do agree. Actually, I inquired from the people who are living surrounding that area also.
Okay.
Very peculiar. Those people are staying that place and moving out of that place, they are not getting disease.
Okay.
I inquired. Mm-hmm. The people who are migrated and married to the local population and settling down there, they are only getting this problem.
Yeah.
This
probably
kind of problem.
With the genetic basis, some triggering some, environment,
water,
trigger,
something
is
and they do have, they have done all kinds of environmental and water analysis.
Yeah, they could not find anything.
They couldn't find any reason behind that.
Yeah.
But as I said, I tried to identify like a genetic disorders, but I couldn't find, means the way they explained to us, it's nothing to related to genetics, what I understood.
Okay.
But I just want to eagerly know, do we find any specific
We are analyzing now, I'll let you know if we find anything.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I must thank,
Thangaraj
for
thank
a wonderful, simplified way of explaining a very complex problem.
Thank you.
And
thank
he
you.
Has historically taken it forward. I'm so proud to say that I came to Delhi 22 years back with a dream that genomics will be there in India, the technology and the capability, both in laboratory, health, disease, as well as industry. Today, we have nearly 200 industries. We have about $800 million of turnover. And this is because, according to me, the both CCMB and IGIB played the major role. Both, I wish Lalji Singh was alive, and two of us, but then our subsequent generation, Thangaraj and Dr. Vinod and Sridhar, my students, they have now finished 1,000 genome, including 100 genome of people who are 91 years plus active without any disease and who are moves around. So we might, those who are elderly, they might soon give us some results to say what makes them to live long. 99 plus, not out. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for your time. And I must thank all the audience for spending time.